time as Isaac Newton, Christian Huygens put forward the wave theory of light. And this is a, there is a small animation. I will try to, maybe some of you can see. So this shows the wave coming out from an animation showing the wave coming out from an orifice. And he studied refraction of light, and he also derived Snell's law. But everyone, Isaac Newton had such a towering personality that people believed more in Isaac Newton rather than Christian Huygens. And so the wave theory got suppressed, and people thought that light was indeed emitted in the form of particles, because light could propagate through vacuum. So let me tell you, what is a wave? A wave is a propagation of disturbance. So if you have a string, and if you make it move up and down, let us suppose in the x direction, and you generate what is known as an x polarized wave, the displacement of the string can be written by this equation. As you all know, x sub zt is equal to a cos kz minus omega t. This equation defines a wave. And why does it define a particular wave? Because if I write this equation, x sub zt is equal to, I'm saying this little slowly so that some of you who would like to write down the equations in their notebook can do that. A cos kz minus omega t. So you take out k, and it can be written as z minus vt, where v is equal to omega by k. V is defined to be omega by k. And I will show you that V indeed represents the velocity of the wave. And I can show that by that if at t equal to zero, I write this equation, then I get A cos of kz. And at a slightly later time, it becomes A cos kz minus V delta t. So at t equal to zero, the shape of the string is like this. And a little later time, the whole string has moved by a distance V delta t in time delta t. And so therefore V, which is defined to be equal to omega by k, represents the velocity of the wave. I repeat that if the displacement is given by A cos kz minus omega t, then this equation represents a wave which is propagating in the z direction with the velocity v, which is defined to be omega by k. So if from physical consideration I can find an equation of this type, then I can predict the existence of waves. So there is an animation that you can go to this website and see. And so you see that each these green points are moving up and down, and the wave is propagating in the forward direction. So when you have time, you can go through this animation. You go to phetcolorado.edu, and there are very beautiful animation using which you can study the propagation of waves on a string. If you rotate the string on the circumference of a circle, then each point on the string moves on a circle. And if this point on the string is moving in a clockwise direction, then you generate what is known as a right circularly polarized wave. And each point of the string rotates on the circumference of a circle. So that is the concept of a wave. Wave is a propagation of a disturbance. It can be an X polarized wave or a Y polarized wave or even a circularly polarized wave. So this animation, if some of you can see, then tells you how the wave propagates, how the disturbance propagates, for example, on the surface of water. Now, if there are two point sources, then each one produces its own displacement, and you have to use the principle of superposition of waves to study the resultant intensity pattern, as most of you must have done even in your high school. So you form what are known as the interference fringes. So these two sources are vibrating in phase. Each sends out a disturbance, and they superpose to form an interference pattern. That is the characteristic of a wave. So the wave interference results because of the superposition principle, according to which the resultant displacement at a particular point produced by a number of waves is the vector sum of the displacements produced by each one of the disturbances. So that is the superposition principle. Because of that, and this diagram has been taken from the Feynman lectures, if you have a wave source which emits spherical waves of the type I have shown earlier, it is allowed to pass through two small orifices, and then they superpose. So I1 is the intensity distribution when hole number one is open. I2 is the intensity distribution when hole number two is open. But when with both holes opening, you form the interference pattern. So that is the characteristic of waves which lead to the superposition principle and therefore the interference of two waves. So this is the actual interference pattern produced from two point sources vibrating in phase on a ripple tank. So you have two point sources which are moving up and down, each sending out a wave, and let us suppose because of one there is a displacement produced by a molecule, the other also produced another disturbance, the resultant disturbance is the sum of the two disturbances, is the vector sum of the two displacements. So Thomas Young in 1801 carried out a very beautiful experiment. He allowed light of a particular color to pass through the two narrow holes. It is not a double slit experiment, it's a double hole experiment. And on the screen, he observed interference fringes. And one could obtain interference fringes only if light is a wave. And as you all know, that if it was a bunch of particles that are coming on the screen, then the particles will either go through hole number one or hole number two. In P1 is the intensity distribution produced when it passes through hole number one is open, and P2 is the intensity distribution when hole number two is open. So when both holes are open, There is no interference. The bullets pass through hole number one or hole number two, and you observe this P12, which is P1 plus P2. So this is the characteristic of a particle. So there is no interference. So therefore, because light plus light could produce darkness, that is the basic consequence of Thomas Young's interference experiment. Light was established to be a wave phenomenon. He could calculate, as you must have read, the wavelength of the light wave from this formula, where beta is the fringe width, d is the distance between the two holes, and capital D is the distance between this plane and this plane. So he could calculate the wavelength of the waves and establish the wave nature of light. So this is considered to be one of the most beautiful experiments in optics. The main question arose that if light was a wave, then how could it propagate through vacuum? How could it propagate? Because you require a medium, there should be a displacement. If light could propagate through vacuum, and as you all know, sunlight reaches the surface of the earth and it passes through vacuum. And so if it was indeed a wave, how could light propagate through vacuum? So now around the beginning of the 19th century, laws of electricity and magnetism were getting developed. Faraday had shown that a changing magnetic field produces an electromotive force. That if you have a magnet which you move up and down, then on this coil there is a current which passes through. Maxwell wrote this law in the form of an equation. So this, where H is the magnetic field and E is the electric field and mu zero is the magnetic permeability of free space, describes what is known as Faraday's law. And physically it means that a changing magnetic field produces a changing electric field. Similarly, around 1827, Ampere had discovered that the current had produced a magnetic field. And this is Ampere's law as put in a mathematical form by Maxwell. Curl of H is equal to J, where J is the current density. And physically, it implies that a current produces a magnetic field. What Maxwell did was that he said that not only the current produces a magnetic field, but a changing electric field also produces a magnetic field. So if there is a changing electric field, like between two plates of a condenser, then you have, physically it is known as the displacement current, which produces the magnetic field. Introducing this concept of displacement current by Maxwell revolutionized physics, because what essentially he did was that he rewrote the laws of electricity and magnetism in the form of equations. First was the Faraday's law, and the second was the Ampere's law, in which he introduced the concept of displacement current. By introducing an equation of the type, a wave-like equation, would satisfy these equations. So if you substitute this equation, for example, in the first equation, this is a wave-like, because this represents a wave. So you can find out there is a corresponding magnetic field, which is, just one second, Just one second. So what Maxwell's most important contribution was that from his equations, he could predict the existence of waves. And he substituted this, he substituted these equations, wave-like equations in his laws of electricity and magnetism. He could calculate omega by k. And therefore, he predicted the existence of waves. And he could calculate omega by k to be equal to, in free space, 1 over under root of mu 0 epsilon 0. The values of mu 0 and epsilon 0 in FKS units are given by this. So when you substitute that, you will get C is equal to the velocity of electromagnetic waves to be 3 into 10 to the power of 8 meters per second. So let me, so he calculated this, Maxwell calculated this, and since this value was close to the velocity of light, he said light must be an electromagnetic wave. So that was one of the greatest contribution in science, greatest synthesis. So around 1864, Maxwell predicted the existence of electromagnetic waves and said that light itself is an electromagnetic wave. Associated with a light wave, there is an electric field, oscillating electric field, and oscillating electric field made an oscillating magnetic field, and an oscillating magnetic field created an oscillating electric field, and that is how electromagnetic waves propagated in free space. So around 1864, Maxwell predicted, Maxwell established that light is indeed a wave, and that it is an electromagnetic wave, and that associated with a light wave are electric and magnetic fields. So this was a revolutionary contribution made by Maxwell around the middle of the 19th century. So one can say that God said there are glasses, the cups that are available, glasses. God said that let there be Maxwell's equations and there would be light. And then Heinrich Hertz established electromagnetic waves from an LCR circuit, and he got the electromagnetic waves of much smaller frequency than that of light and got it reflected by an aluminum screen and formed standing waves. So Heinrich Hertz established the existence of he created electromagnetic waves of smaller frequency and established the electromagnetic nature of light waves. So this is the entire electromagnetic spectrum. So you have X-rays which are characterized by very high frequencies. Higher frequencies are gamma rays. Then you have ultraviolet. The visible portion of the light occupies a very tiny region of the electromagnetic spectrum. And then you have infrared rays and microwaves and radio waves. They are all electromagnetic waves. They are characterized by different frequencies and different wavelengths. Gamma rays have the highest frequency and smallest wavelength, and radio waves have the smallest frequency and the highest wavelength. But all wavelengths travel in free space with an identical velocity of 299792458 meters per second. So around the end of the 19th century, it was established that light was indeed a wave. Light was indeed a wave, and that it was an electromagnetic wave. Now, let me skip these two slides. Maybe I'll come back to that later. So around the turn of the century, Max Planck, who was a great theoretical physicist, said that Maxwell's theory remains for all times one of the greatest triumphs of human intellectual endeavor. In fact, in 1894, the famous physicist Lord Kelvin said, "There is nothing new to be discovered in physics now. All that remains is more and more precise measurements." Then came Einstein. And Einstein, as you all know, was in 1905, he was working in the Swiss patent office. And 1905 was Einstein's year of miracles, where in 1 year, sitting in total isolation in the Swiss patent office, he published 5 outstanding papers. And in the second paper, in his year of miracles, Einstein wrote that light consists of indivisible quanta of energy. That is, packets of energy. These quanta are now known as photons. And the energy of each quantum is h nu, and the momentum associated with each photon is h nu by c. Dr. Saxena, some of the students are saying that they cannot see any slides. So that's why many people have left the video.
No, they must have joined now, sir.
But many people...
Please continue. I'll tell them.
Acha, okay. Thank you. Okay. Okay. So light consists of individual... So therefore, Einstein put forward the corpuscular model of light, introduced the light quantum, whose energy is E is equal to h nu, and whose momentum is equal to h nu by c. This was a revolutionary concept which led to wave-particle duality and development of quantum theory. Using his light quantum, as you all know, Einstein could explain the photoelectric effect. Now, one of the main characteristics of the photoelectric effect is that, what is photoelectric effect? That light incident on a plate like sodium or potassium, and if the frequency of the light wave is greater than a certain value, then it will emit photoelectrons. And what Einstein derived with his simple concept of the photon said that the maximum kinetic energy of the emitted electron was equal to h nu, where nu is the frequency of the light wave and b is a constant, which is a characteristic of the metal. And he wrote that in the form of h nu minus nu c, where h nu c is equal to b. This equation is known as the Einstein equation, and which was very carefully verified by Robert Millikan in 1914. So I'll repeat what Einstein said. Most of you would know this. He explained the photoelectric effect. And one of the characteristics of the photoelectric effect is, listen to this carefully, that It has a critical frequency. Light below a certain frequency, no matter how intense it is, it is not able to eject any photoelectrons. And so therefore, he said that light must consist of quanta, packets of energy. And this equation, which is known as Einstein's equation, was carefully verified by Robert Millikan for many, many metals. But even then, no one really believed in Einstein's light quantum. Everyone believed in the wave theory that was put forward by Maxwell. And then it was only when Compton carried out the experiment in which a light beam of a particular frequency is scattered by the electron, and the scattered light has a slightly lower frequency, and there is a certain energy that is imparted to the electron. He assumed that the energy of the photon to be equal to h nu, and the momentum to be equal to h nu by c. And then he applied simple laws of conservation of momentum and energy. These are the two, the conservation of x and y components of the momentum. X is in the vertical direction, y is in the horizontal direction. And from this, he derived that the shift in the frequency or the shift in the wavelength was given by this formula. It's a very simple derivation. It is given in almost all books on modern physics. So including the books that I have referred to earlier in the course. So this is the change in the wavelength, which is equal to 2 times the Planck's constant divided by the rest mass of the electron. C is the speed of light multiplied by sine squared theta by 2, where theta is the angle of scattering, angle by which the light gets scattered with a lower frequency. And this is the formula which was verified experimentally by Arthur Compton in 1923. And it was only after this experiment that people started believing in Einstein's photon. So, for example, if I take a 50-watt sodium lamp, say sodium lamp has a wavelength of about 6 into 10 to the power of minus 7 meters, the corresponding frequency you can calculate, which is equal to C by lambda. C is 3 into 10 to the power of 8 divided by 6 into 10 to the power of minus 7, which gives a frequency of 5 into 10 to the power of 14 hertz. So a 50-watt sodium lamp emits 50 joules per second divided by the energy of each photon, which is h is so much and nu is so much. If you divide, you will get 150 into 10 to the power of 18 photons per second. This is just to give you a ballpark figure of the number of photons that is emitted by a typical 50 watt sodium lamp. And if you put the sodium lamp at a distance of about 10 meters from a small hole, which is about 0.1 millimeter in radius, then about 40 million photons per second will come out of the circular hole. This is just to give you an idea of the number of photons that are emitted by a light source. So this is a beautiful experiment, which is a series of photographs showing the quality of a picture obtainable from various number of photons. On the top left-hand corner corresponds to 3,000 photons. And you can see that the photons arrive at random at different places. And slowly, as the number of photons increases, this corresponds to 12,000. This is 93,000, 760,000, and the last photograph corresponds to 28 million photons. And you slowly the structure of the phase appears. So quantum theory, as we will see later, gives us the probability distribution for the arrival of the photons. Where an individual photon will arrive, no one can say. One can only give a probability distribution. And if you did the experiment with a large number of photons, then slowly the result that you expect from the wave theory will appear. We will discuss this in greater detail when we consider the single slit and double slit interference pattern. Now, as you all know, that J.J. Thomson discovered the electrons in 1897. You could deflect the electron, it has a certain mass, certain charge, and now we know the mass of the electron to 10 decimal places. So, and the charge of the electron, and it can be deflected by an electric field and a magnetic field, and you can play around with them. So, on the back of my mind, I think electron or a proton or a neutron or an alpha particle as a tiny particle. Then in 1924, Louis de Broglie said that this formula, P is equal to h nu by c, this is the momentum of a photon, which can be written as h by lambda, is also valid for electrons. And this led to wave-particle duality. That he said that this formula, P is equal to h by lambda, which was put forward by Einstein to be valid for a photon, is also valid for electrons. And this was in 1924. This was his doctoral thesis. It was only, and how did he justify it? Because at that time, Niels Bohr had presented his Bohr model of the atom, in which he said that the angular momentum of the electron was equal to nh by 2 pi. This he had put forward in 1913 or 1914. So Bohr had described the hydrogen atom, had put forward, as you all know, the discrete orbits of the electron in a hydrogen atom. And the discrete orbits correspond to mvr as an integral multiple of h over 2 pi. So n is 1, 2, 3, 4, and this corresponds, for example, for n is equal to 6, it will be, the angular momentum will be 6 times h over 2 pi. Now this equation means that 2 pi r, that is the circumference of the ring, is equal to nh by mv. I take h here and mv here, which is equal to nh by pi, p. So this is 2 pi r is equal to n lambda. So he justified the concept of the wavelength of the electron by saying that the each Bohr orbit is something like a stationary wave and corresponds to an integral number of wavelengths associated with the electron. This is how he justified the wavelength of the electron. And this wave, I thought I will show you that Niels Bohr had visited Delhi University in 1959. And we had heard a lecture from him. And I am here, then this is Professor R.P. Mitra, and this is Professor F.C. Oller, who was my teacher in, who taught us classical mechanics and also a little bit of quantum mechanics. So then it was only in 1926 that the wave nature of electrons was experimentally established. And this was established by Davison and Germer in New York, and Thomson and Thomson by in United Kingdom. Actually, the experiment was carried out by son of J.J. Thomson. J.J. Thomson discovered the electron, and G.P. Thomson, his son, he established the wave nature of electrons. This is the diffraction pattern produced by X-rays by an aluminum foil. As you know, X-rays are electromagnetic waves. And this is the diffraction pattern produced by electrons by an aluminum foil. Look at the similarity of the two photographs. And so therefore, and since light also, light is a wave, therefore electron also depicted a wave nature. And so therefore, after this, the question arose whether light or the electron, whether the photons are particles or waves. So the electron or a proton is a wave or a particle. The correct answer to that question is, as described by Feynman in the famous Feynman lectures, that they are neither waves nor particles. So some books write that they are sometimes a wave and sometimes a particle. And some books write that they are waves and particles. None of them are the correct answer. The correct answer is given, very described very beautifully in Feynman's volume, and that they are neither waves nor particles. But that does not answer the question that what is an electron? And therefore the answer is that it is the wave. It is described that the electron or the proton or an alpha particle is described by the wave function psi. And what is that wave function? The wave function psi is the solution of the Schrodinger equation. And Richard Feynman writes in his famous volume 3 that where did we get that equation from? The answer is nowhere. It is not possible to derive it from anything you know. And Richard Feynman writes, it came out of the mind of Schrodinger. You cannot, I will give a heuristic derivation of the Schrodinger equation, but that is not an exact derivation. That lacks rigor. That is what I want to emphasize. Similarly, the Maxwell's equations that I wrote down cannot be derived. They cannot be derived. They are based on experimental laws, the Faraday's law and the Ampere's law as modified by Maxwell. Similarly, the Schrodinger equation. So therefore, listen to this carefully. Is the electron a particle or a wave? The correct answer is that it is neither a particle nor a wave. It is described by the wave function psi, and I will physically interpret this equation, which is a solution. What is this wave function psi? Which is a solution of this equation, which is known as the Schrodinger equation. And I will give you a very heuristic derivation of the Schrodinger equation. It is so famous that people have tattooed them on their back. That, let us suppose I take a plane wave. Let us suppose I take a plane wave described by the wave function psi of x comma t. Then we have the de Broglie relation that p is equal to h by lambda is equal to h by 2 pi multiplied by 2 pi by lambda. H by 2 pi is h cross multiplied by 2 pi by lambda, which I write as k. So p is equal to h cross k. And so therefore k I can write as p by h cross, where h cross is defined to be equal to h by 2 pi. We also have the Einstein relation, which is e is equal to h nu, which is h by 2 pi into 2 pi nu, which is h cross omega. Because h by 2 pi is h cross and 2 pi nu is omega. So this is, therefore, omega is equal to e by h cross. Now, I have used wave-particle duality as put forward by de Broglie and the Einstein relation. and I substitute these two here. So if I, this is a wave function, and I somehow introduce in an ad hoc way the particle nature. So I get I by h cross px minus et. And for a free particle, E is equal to p square by 2m. So now I substitute, you see, I substitute for E equal to p square by 2m here, I get a e to the power of I by h cross px minus p square by 2m into t. And then I differentiate it once, and I get with respect to time, so I get p square by 2m into the whole function, which is psi. And differentiate partially with respect to x, and I get p square by 2m from here, and h cross square in the denominator, which gets cancelled from this h cross square. So p square by 2m times psi. So you see the right hand sides are the same. So I equate the left hand sides and I get this. So this is a very heuristic derivation of the Schrodinger equation and lacks rigor. But this I take as the truth and then study the solution. And this is what I will do in the next lecture.